Okay, I guess we can start. Thank you all for coming. It's great to be here. Thank you for having me. So I would like to talk a bit today on how to do event sourcing using Slick and leveraging transactions. My name is Adam Warski. So for a start, there's this conference application that I guess you all have on your phones, and I think the way it works that is after the talk you have to go and press the green button over there. So yeah, but more seriously, please do that, as feedback is very important both for the organizers so that they know who not to invite next time, and for me as well. If you have any questions throughout the talk, please please ask right away. I will try to answer if I can. Okay, so what is event sourcing? I guess we already more or less have some feeling what this means. There's a lot of good articles on the web by people like Martin Fowler or Greg Young, and I'm not going to try to compete with them. But for our purposes, I guess we can define it. Event sourcing is an approach, an architecture, where all changes in our system are captured as a sequence of events. And the events are the main driver of what happens in our application. So we'll see more concretely what this means, of course, later on. So why would we consider using an event source architecture? So in many cases, event sourcing is used for scalability and performance reasons. So when using a relational database, that's maybe not the main factor, as the DB can be the limiting thing here. So, but there are also other reasons. So for me, one of the reasons is that I'm working in IT, which stands for information technology. And very often in traditional CRUD applications, what happens, especially with the R and the U, is that data gets destroyed, right? We either delete data or overwrite existing data. And so we lose information, and you never know when that information can be useful in the future. So maybe it's a good idea to actually keep as much as possible. Okay. Also, this approach actually has or can have a business benefit. So unlike a fancy new web framework, using event sourcing can have a business benefit because you automatically get an audit log of all the actions in the system. And this very often comes as a requirement, maybe not in the initial stages of a project, but maybe later on. And then you can say, hey, it's already in the database. Another thing for testing, you can quite easily recreate the system state at any point in time when using event sourcing. So that can be quite useful for debugging when you have that nasty production issue. So there's quite a lot of reasons besides scalability and performance to use event sourcing. So I actually have a history with auditing. So I guess you don't often see Hibernate on the screen on a Scala conference. So, but yeah, here it is. So like a couple of years ago, I wrote, back when I was a Java coder, I wrote this extension Hibernate called Hibernate Anniverse. And the way it worked is each time you saved you saved an entity to the database, you merged it with the Hibernate session, a row was added to the history table, and that way you got an audit of all the past states, and you can read the history and so on. So this was like the other way around, right? So in Anniverse, you did the changes, like in a typical CRUD fashion, and then in the reaction to that, the history was written. In event sourcing, it's the other way around. And we will be doing things the other way around. So first come the events, which update our model, as we will see in a bit. And when we are talking about me, just a short introduction so that you know who's talking to you. I'm a software engineer at Softermal. I code mainly in Scala, which probably is not a surprise. My company is a Lightdent consulting partner, so we are a software house, we do Scala software for clients all over the world, using Scala, but also Java and Groovy. We have a newsletter, Scala Times, which maybe you have heard about. If not, please check it out. I'm involved in some open source projects. I have a blog and a Twitter account, so we can follow me. Okay, so what's our goal? So we want, by using Slick transactions and event sourcing. So we want to get the benefits of event sourcing. Plus, we still want to leverage what the database gives us. So we want to somehow take advantage of the fact that we do have the transactions, which are an expensive thing, right? But they do give us, for example, some consistency guarantees. So we want to use that, right? We want to use the way we can define the schema. And most importantly, I think we want to be able to issue SQL queries to explore our data. We want to make it possible for business analysts to use SQL as they did before to query the data. So how are we going to do that? There are also a number of other approaches which usually use a NoSQL data store and they are eventually consistent. So they have different challenges and different benefits. So for example, Event Store, Akka Persistence, and Eventuate. These are all great solutions, but they maybe fit a bit of different use cases than the ones that fit like as a replacement for a typical CRUD application. So what we are going to try to do here. Okay, so being more specific. Events in our case will always be immutable. So once an event happens, it never changes. It says something about what already happened. So events will be always expressed in past tense, right? For example, user registered, which means that a user has registered in our system. And the events will be the primary source of truth in our system. Everything else will be derived. On a more implementation level, so events will be modeled as case classes. They will be serialized to JSON for storage in the database. Each event has a certain type. The type will typically be the name of the case class. Now, each event, such as user registered, can be bound to some aggregate. So the aggregate, for example, can be user, right? So this event is about something, some entity in our system, some aggregate. So we can have many events for a single aggregate, like user registered, user added a friend, and so on. So of course, an event has a unique ID, a timestamp, so we can track them in time. Many events can happen in a single transaction, so we will also capture the transaction ID. So all events in a single transaction will have the same transaction ID. And for auditing purposes, we may also, for example, want to capture the user ID, who was logged in. When the event was created. So that can be useful for tracking and for blaming users for what they did. Okay, so how are we going to do that? So we have a relational database. So of course, the events will be stored in there. So there will be a dedicated table where we will store the events, like a single table with all the events in them. And now, based on the events, we will create a read model. Okay, but what is important is that we will update the read model based on the event in the same transaction as writing the event. So this gives us some quite nice consistency guarantees. We don't have the gap between persisting the event and updating the read model that we have in other event sourcing architectures. But this comes as a cost because we have to use transactions. So the read model is quite similar to what a traditional CRUD model might be. Okay, so when you will be issuing our SQL queries to explore the data, we will be using our read model. Just take a drink. So going even on a more technical level, to talk to the database, we will use Slick. So Slick has the concept of a DBI IO action, and that's actually a description of actions that should be done to the database. So for example, if you ask Slick, please insert this row, or please run this query, what you get is an action, a DBIO action, and that's a description. Nothing is being actually run against the database yet. It's only a description. You can then execute that action, and that will go to the database. So why this two-step process? Well, it's kind of like a free monad thing, if you are familiar with these things. So the nice thing here is that you can get, for example, a bunch of actions from various places of your code. And these are only like descriptions, like they don't do anything, right? They are just descriptions. So you can get a bunch of these, sequence them into one big action, and say dot transactional, and that will be run in a single transaction. Okay? So that's a layer of abstraction that Slix gives us that we will be using. And these actions can be sequenced using flat maps, so they form a monad, but that's not really important right now. Okay, so before we get coding, just a quick overview of the flow that that we will see here. So what we will see is that some user data comes into our system, like the username for the user to be registered. And now everything will happen in a single transaction. Okay, so that user data comes in into a command. So the command is a normal Scala method accepting some user data. So the command like tells the system what to do, right? So the command can now use the read model, which is populated by the events, right? It's a secondary thing. So the command can use the read model to validate the user data. For example, check if the user with that username doesn't already exist. So once that validation is done, the command emits a number of events. Okay? So these events will be persisted in the database, but they also go into the event processor. So the event processor now uses the registry. The registry is just a bunch of maps from event type to actions, saying what should be done when this event is emitted. And what can be done? Well, two kind of things. The first is a model update. So basing on an event, we can update our read model, right? So we can write new data to the read model. And when we want to, for example, recreate the system state at some point in time, we will only run these model update functions, okay? The other kind of thing that can happen is an event listener. So an event listener will run some arbitrary side effects and business logic in reaction to an event. And we want to run these event listeners only once when the event happens. For example, an event listener can send an email, right? We don't want to send an email every time we recreate our system state, okay? So the event listeners can use the other data present in the read model. They can emit more events, and they can interact with external systems. Okay? Now, all of these components, as we'll see in code, they will usually be modeled by simple Scala methods and functions. Okay? But just please make a kind of a mental picture, as it might be useful, like when we will translate this to code. Okay, so now let's get to the actual coding part. So, I will be using a library which is called Slick Event Sourcing. It's, I think more of it about it as a template, not a framework or anything like that. It's more like a template that you probably will have to copy and customize when you want to write your own application in that way. It's just it's very short, it's quite simple code, but I'm not going to write it all because I don't have time for that. But, well, you will see what it contains. Okay, so the first entry point were commands, right? So first what we need to do is we need to write our commands. What is the application going to do? So we are going to write a simple app for signing up to buy a Tesla Model 3 car. That's a very fashionable thing to do, right? After you buy an iPhone, iPad, you go buy a Tesla. So we are going to write an app which allows you to register to buy one, and because it's a very scarce thing, you are only allowed to buy one at a time. Okay, so we will have a command called place order. It's a normal Scala method so far. And that's the name of the person actually ordering the car. Okay, so what should be the result type of this method? Our command can either fail or succeed, right? Because it's gonna fail because you have already ordered one or not. So the result type should be something like either error, so on the left you have the error, or unit, meaning that everything is fine and the order is placed. However, together with the result, we also want to emit some events, right? So the command validates the data and emits some events. So, well, it should return a tuple. and the list of event, okay? But it can also validate against the database, so we have to wrap all of this into a DB IO action. Now that's quite an ugly type, okay? So that's why in the library I was mentioning, there's a nice alias for that called command result string unit. I guess it kind of reveals the intention better. So we can go to the source and you can see that it's a type alias. Nothing magical, just an alias saying exactly what we wrote in the code before, okay? So that's a command which either returns a string describing the failure or a unit meaning success. Okay, so the first thing we are going to do is we actually have to check against the database if the person ordered a car or not. I have a class ready which allows us to read the model, but first let me show the model. So that is going to be our read model for the placed orders, okay? That's a very simple SQL table, ID name and equipment, which is optional, okay? I guess nobody should be surprised seeing that. So that's one table that we have in our database. The other table are events. Okay? So events, each event has an ID, as I said, that's the serialized payload, name of the case class, the logged in user ID, the timestamp, and so on. Also, I have a mapping for the orders table into Scala, and I have it read over here because it's a bit of slick code, right? Let me just go over it very quickly. So that's how you map a table to Scala code. So here you can see the table name. Here we have the three columns defined as Scala metadata. And you also in Slack you have to say like which three columns should be used when selecting every or the whole thing. So ID name and equipment. And when we say that these three columns should be converted to a Tesla order case class, which is over here. So the Tesla order is a representation of a single row from our read model. Okay, I guess it's quite simple, right? So we have the read model over here, right? And here we have the Scala representation. So that's the Tesla order model, that's our read model, right? It also has some helper classes, so for example, we can find all orders, right? And this returns an action, with the action when run, will give us a list of all the orders, right? We can find by name, which will give us an optional single order, and we can also update the read model later with a new order, but we will see that later. Okay, so now what we want to do in our command, we want to use the Tesla order model, and we want to find by name, and that gives an action, so we flat map it. So you always flat map in Scala. In case an order has been found for that person, we return a failure. Command result.fail. You already ordered one. And the failed is a convenience thing. It just returns a successful action which contains a left of the either. No events. No events this time. Okay, going back here. So if there are no orders, well, then we create our event, right? We want to emit an event. So first we have to write that event. So event will be a simple case class, Tesla ordered for a given person. Okay, so that's our event payload. And it's in past tense, right? Because the Tesla has been ordered already, and that's going to be our event. So our event is going to be, we create the event, that's the payload, but we also have to wrap it in the metadata, right? The ID, the timestamps, and so on. So that's where the library again comes in. There's an event wrapper, and we say that it's a new aggregate route. So we can also bind it to an existing aggregate route, right? And this only populates the metadata fields automatically. We'll also automatically create an ID, for example, using a generator, so that we don't have to do it every time. And now we say that it's a command result.successful, and we return a unit saying that everything is fine, plus we emit the event. Well, we don't re-emit the event, we just return it from the method, right? So the method will return right unit plus a list of events, single event. Okay, we will wire it all up a bit later. So now, the second thing to do is we have to say what should happen in reaction to our events, okay? So remember that over here we had our model updates and our event listeners, so let's write those, right? We have the command, we emit the event, now we have to write those. So let's do it. Event listeners, and we will need an implicit execution context, that's something you always need in Scala as well. And in our event listener, we will simply send an email to the customer saying that it was successful. Send customer notification, and it's an event listener for the Tesla ordered event. So that's again a type alias. So what is it? Let's go. So an event listener is a function. It's a plain Scala function, okay? It takes an event, like we have defined before, with payload of type T, and what it does, it returns an action because we can use the read model in our event. It returns an action which can, you know, run any side effects, and it can also emit some events, okay? So this corresponds, so the list of events emitted corresponds to this arrow, and we can also run some side effects, which isn't really visible in the type, unfortunately, but, well, you can. We'll see in a second how. Okay, so that's a function. Since it's a function, we take in an event, that's E, and now we have an email service ready, send email, so we can go check out the implementation. It's just doing a print line. Okay, it's a very simple email service, but it works. It doesn't send email, though. So we will say in the email your Tesla model 3 will be ready in a couple of years. Yeah. Okay. So, well, we are not ready yet. The send email, oh, that's small. So the send email, it's like it just returns a future, right? It's an asynchronous email service. It doesn't return a DBIO action. Luckily, we can convert a future into DBIO action, saying DBIO action dot from. And this wraps a future and returns like a fake DBIO action, okay? But we can use it together with other DBIO actions just as well. Okay, so that's our event listener. And now, that's not everything, because we have to return a list of events to emit, so we map the unit to an empty list. No further events emitted. So for example, here we could emit like, add some extra equipment, right, because they are ordering early, and that would be a new event, which would be again processed by the same machinery. So model updates now. We need the Tesla order model here. Okay. And again, we will have an ordered updated. And that will be a model update. And we'll see what is in a second. Tesla ordered. That's our event type. Okay, so the model update, again, it's an alias for a function. So the function is quite similar. It takes an event, and it does something to the database, right? It doesn't return anything, but what's important is the DBIO action here has an additional effects type parameter, saying what the DBIO action can actually do to the database, right? And you can notice that in the event listener, you can only read from the database. In the model update, we actually want to write as well, right? Because we update the read model. So we have read with write. So on a type level, you can also control what kind of things you can do to the database. Unless you do a cast, so then. That's quite easy. Tesla order model, update new. Now we have to create a representation of the row in the database. So from the Tesla ordered event, we create a Tesla order database row, right? So we take the aggregate ID, which will be automatically generated because we said it's a new aggregate. And from the data, so from the payload, we will extract the name. So the name here is this one. And there's no extra equipment. And the type checked. Okay, that's good. So now we have the three pieces. Now what we need is this event processor and this registry, right? So again, here comes in the library that I mentioned. You can take a look at the source code of it later. It's really very simple. So the registry is here, and it is just a wrapper for a bunch of maps, from event type to a list of model updates, and from event type to a list of event listeners. So let's use that. So I'll just instantiate our commands here. Commands Tesla order model, and we will need an instance of event listeners. So it's just plain Scala objects, nothing really complicated, right? Just plain Scala objects and functions so far. New model updates, Tesla order model, okay. So yeah, that's just a normal Scala class, right? And it contains a value, which is a function, right? You can even, maybe not unit test it because it touches the database, but write a quite lightweight test which verifies that this function does what it should do. Okay? It doesn't have any dependencies except the read model. Okay, so now we are going to register an event listener. So we are just passing in the function. And we are going to register the model update. Okay, so we have our registry. Now, the last piece of the puzzle is, so we have a command which returns the events. It was just a tuple, right? It just returns the event and nothing happened to them. So we need to somehow feed them into the event processor. And we are going to do that in a second. Okay, so what we are going to do is I have a simple REST API, just an HTTP API, which we'll use for a demo in a second. So that's in the roots. So here I will have two endpoints for placing an order and listing on orders. So the list all orders one is quite simple. I'm using Akka HTTP, if you don't recognize this beautiful API. So okay, so what we need here, this will be our roots. We need a couple of dependencies. I will just quickly add them and explain in a second what they do. We need the read model, and we need the commands. Okay, so first the endpoint for listing orders. So when we list orders, what we do is we take the Tesla order model and we find all. But that's a description, and now we have to run that against the database. So we use the that's the slick DB object, okay? Just wrapped in a configured class. So we use the run method to actually run the action. This gives us a future. So now we wait until the future is done. And when the future is done, orders, we just return them to the caller. Complete. And orders.map for a single order, we are going to just map it to its name. And we are just going to return them as a list separated by new lines. So not anything very sophisticated, or even the other way around, very unsophisticated. Okay, so that's listing the orders. Now the more interesting part, of course, is actually running the command and feeding it into an event processor. Okay, so when the place order endpoint is invoked, right? It's a post. So somebody posted to our endpoint. We extract the name of the person from the entity. So again, a very simple thing. Probably not what you would do in production. But here it is. So the first thing we do is we take our commands and we invoke the place order method that we have just written, okay, with the name. So that's the name, that's the method here, right, which returns the command result. So what we get here is a description of some DB actions which will result in either fail or success
plus a list of events. So nothing yet happened. Okay, we just created a description, nothing happened. So what we want to do is we somehow want to convert a command result with failure success into a future failure success, right? But also running all the events as a side process. So that's what the event machine does. The event machine has a run method which takes in a command result and produces a future of an either FS, right? So that's more or less what we want. But it also uses the registry where all the mappings for the model updates and the event listeners are defined to actually run all the event logic. Okay? Again, that class, you can see that it's not long. It's quite simple. It just, you know, for given it takes the command, it takes the events, looks up the model updates, the event listeners, invokes them, puts it all in a single transaction, and runs it. OK, so we will run our command. OK, so we have now our command is run, so we get a future. So again, we wait until the future is done. So this on success, if you're not familiar with Akka HTTP, that's a directive which waits until the future is, well, which runs code when the future is complete and responds to the caller. So when we get an error from our command, we do a complete status code bad request and we send back the error. And if everything was fine, we complete with an OK. OK, that should work. Let's try compile it. It will fail. Hopefully, if it doesn't fail, I will be surprised. It failed because I didn't put in the dependencies here. So I need to wire this up. If I was using Anverse, of course, things would be different. I'm not. OK. And it will fail again. But that's, you know, Scala doing the job for us, right? OK, so what's the last missing piece here is that we have to specify what is the aggregate for this event. So there's a couple of ways to do it. I'm going to do it with an implicit. It's not very important. It's not like anything crucial. It's just a technical requirement of this library. So implicit is an aggregate for event. So we specify that for the Tesla ordered event, the Tesla order is our aggregate root. Okay, so that's the event. That's our aggregate root. Okay, so now let's try running it. And we are missing an implicit execution context. Okay. Now I will be really surprised if it fails. Okay, it didn't. All the planned failures are used. Okay, so we can see that something is running. Server started. Let me just put a new. Okay, localhost 8080. Okay, so I didn't delete the testing data, so that it is there, but we can place an order for, let's say, Kate. Order placed. Now, so it's not very very dramatic, but we can see what's happening in the logs. So in the logs, you can see that, for example, the event machine said that it's handling an event, right? The event was, here, handling event, right? We have an auto-generated event ID. That's the event type. That's the aggregate type, right? Scrolling, sorry. And that's our payload here, okay? So that's the event that we have written, okay? So what happened, the command was run, right? The event was created. We can also see that our email service is working as expected. It's printlining. It sent the email that it should. We can order for another Kate, and it worked again. But now if I try to audit for myself, I will get an error because I already placed an order, right? So that's when this branch kicked in, and no events were emitted. You can see that there are only two events for the Kates, right? OK. Actually, not out of time. That's good. So it's not all that nice. There are some potential problems. So one problem is that when we recreate the state of our system from existing events, and when there are concurrent events touching the same aggregate route. So there are some subtleties in how they should be ordered, right? So if we don't do anything, it may end up that in the real system they are be ordered differently than when we restore the state. So this can be mitigated using either optimistic or pessimistic locking in the database, like so the usual solutions in when using a relational DB. Another thing that some people don't like is that the DBR action leaks quite high as an abstraction in your code, right? So in our case, the DBR action went all the way up to the roots in our demo, right? So, well, that was just a demo, that's one thing. Another is that it can be a problem or it can be a feature. I sometimes see it as a feature because you see exactly what code touches the database, okay? And I think it can be a good thing that you look at something and you can see that this actually will talk to a database. And the future wrapping that I've shown you of the sending emails is also not perfect because the DBR action should describe actions which are not yet running, right? And we have wrapped an existing running future. There's no way to wrap like a future producer or something like that. So, but these are like problems that you, I guess, can overcome. So to summing up, like our main approach, like taking the library away, so it's really small, it's not needed to implement that approach, just one proposition of how you can realize it in Scala, but the main thing that we have used are three functions, okay? These are simple functions which can be like almost unit tested. So the first one was the command, right? The command was a Scala method which took in some user data and produced a command result, which is, and the command result is a pair describing either failure or success and a list of events to be emitted. Okay, so it's quite a simple function. And you don't really get any of that infrastructure in there, right? So you don't, in the command, you don't see the event machine, you don't see any of the event processing and so on. So it's just quite pure logic. You also have the event listener, which describes the side effects, which should happen, right? So for it's a function which takes in an event and returns a list of further events which should be emitted plus some side effects, and it can use the database, and you have the model updates which can be safely recreated many times. So also, for example, if you want at some point to introduce a new projection of your events to a new read model, you can just, you know, rerun all of your events using only these new model update functions, right? So we can amend an existing read model with a new table, let's say, a new projection, which you need for efficiency reasons or something like that. And you can just rerun all the events to populate it. There's no reason why you can't do that, right? So the read model doesn't have to be normalized in any way. You can denormalize as much as you can because it is secondary anyway. It's not the primary source of truth. Okay, so some links. This presentation, of course, is available on GitHub. The code, the library I was using is also on GitHub. I would say it's more of a skeleton which you should customize than a library to use unchanged. There's a long README. It was probably longer than the actual code. Explain what it does, hopefully in a clear way. Okay, so thanks. I'm here until tomorrow. So if you have any questions, please catch me. I have some stickers with me of Scala Times, and we even have, I think, 5 minutes for questions if you would have any.
Hi, one question. Would it make sense to model this as reactive streams, like the events with maybe
yes,
Akka
you
streams?
Can. So luckily, that's already done. So Slick, one of the variants of the DBR action is you can get a streaming result. So you can, for example, get a stream of events, like a reactive stream of events, quite easily. So that's actually, there's a third type parameter in there. So in the DBR action, you can see that there's the type that's wrapped, there's the effects, and there's this streaming specification. Okay, so here's we didn't use the streaming, but you can get a reactive stream of events reading from the database quite easily using Slick.
Yes, I think in the beginning you said something about that one of the benefits from using event sourcing is that you can get increased scalability, and that's something I've heard others say as well. But I don't really see how you get that with this approach.
Because yeah, that's true. Oh, there you are. Okay, I couldn't find you. Okay, so yeah, I said that usually when you're talking about event sourced architectures, the main benefit is that you get scalability. So here, it's not. It's true, because we are using a relational database, and as we know, it's very often limits how far can we scale, and limits, it's the main bottleneck in our performance, right? So if you want to scale beyond even a relational database cluster, then you probably want to go, I don't know, to Cassandra or something like that, or Kafka or whatever, then you should probably use at the other event sourcing libraries, which I pointed out, which are somewhere here. So yeah, again, it depends on your specific problem, right? So if you do need that scalability and that performance, that's also a good reason to use event sourcing. And then I would use, for example, Akka Persistence or Eventuate. If you want to, think that event sourcing is a good fit for your business process application, something like that, as a replacement for a CRUD architecture, then I would go with that approach. Also, what is important is that you don't have to event source everything, right? You can have a couple of endpoints which actually use the whole event machinery and so on, write events generate the event, the read model, and so on. But some endpoints can just be traditional CRUD endpoints where you don't need the history. So these can coexist one by one.
But so this approach, then you're basically just adding an audit log to a relational database, or?
Yeah, well, it's the data store here is the relational database, so that's what limits us in terms of scalability. Yes. So that's here the event sourcing, which I was hoping to explain on this slide. So we are not trying to use event sourcing for scalability, but for other reasons. For not to lose information, to get an audit log, and to be able to recreate the system state, and probably for a couple of other reasons as well. Yes.
Thanks. I'm an avid reader of your blog, as you might know. So
thank you.
It's great, but I can't help but notice that. That's the same thing that you did with free monads, but without free monads. Now, that's okay, yeah. But in few
I'm
times...
I'm just saving material for another talk.
Yeah, but a few times you mentioned that the methods you used are almost unit-testable. I think that they are almost unit-testable, as you said, precisely because you didn't use free monad and you fixed yourself on DBIO action, which is a monad. Whereas, had you used free monad, you would have had perfect testability,
yes,
more or less, because of
Then you could write an interpreter which runs this.
So my question is, why? Why shun the free monads out of the picture?
So I think the free monads add complicated thing a bit more than here. So there's already some price like transferring from a CRUD architecture to writing these functions and these events. That's already some a change of how we write things. And I'm not sure adding free monads would be that beneficial in a general use case. So I think that this applies to a much wider range of systems than the free monad approach would. I know the benefits of free monads, but they don't come for free. They have their price in terms of the mental complexity you have to, the time you have to spend reading the code to understand it. I think, at least that's my case. I don't know, maybe it's only me, but it takes me longer to parse whatever the code does with a free monad. Although you get all the benefits. So I hope this more or less answers.
Hi, how would you model evolution of the commands and of the events? So maybe we want to add telephone number to our order. How would you do that? Because
okay,
the older
that's a good question. So I guess what I would do is let's jump to our logic here. So well, for sure I would keep that class. Okay, well maybe rename it to something like old, something like that. I don't know. But I would add a new one here as well with a phone number. Well, probably with our with the current library, I would keep that name and add I don't know the version or whatever. That's probably not the good. That's not a good idea. But you would have again to change the library. So a phone number over here, right? And well, you have these old events in the database, right? So you need to keep the model updates. The model update functions for these, right? So once, whenever you recreate the model, you have to be able to handle that event and update the read model, maybe using a default phone number, something like that. And I would add a second model update function which would handle that. Well, in I guess it's always an option to modify the event, but it kind of goes against the philosophy. So, and this also shows that there was once such an event, right? But then we added a phone number. Right? This may be also important, for example, in the audit, right? That at some point in time our system didn't have the phone numbers, and then we added the default ones or something like that. So this can be this also is a piece of information that can be valuable, I think. So yeah, you can you probably would need to add some support into the library for now it's a 1-1 mapping, so the case class name is always the event type. Maybe there should be like in the registry, maybe like an extra mapping which would allow you to rename this class to another event type. Okay, I guess we're out of time. So thank you very much again.